This is William Salyers, the voice of Rigby from the regular show, and you are watching the Bois podcast, which you should always do.
Ham boning.
What?
Yeah, dude, ham boning. We just go up to Benson and we'll be all like, we both want raises.
No, man, stop it. We just need to ask him for a raise and just explain all the...
No, that's not gonna work. What are you, 65? Excuse me, sir, can I have a raise? Come on! I'm telling you, dude. Ham boning.
No.
Ham boning will save your life someday. It'll be all like, what? You trying to mug me?
That look on your face. You can't imagine how satisfying it is. Stop! Ready for your final act?
Hello, everyone, and welcome back to an episode of the Bois Podcast. My guest today is a voice actor, and many more. You may have heard his voice as Reverend Putty and Moral Oral, Rigby, Percy, and 230 others in regular show, as Truman Marsh in Avengers Assemble, as Otto Octavius in the Spider-Man video games, and many more. So welcome, Mr. William Salyers. Welcome, Bill.
Thank you, Joe, and please call me Bill. And wow, that's that. I think that you're more familiar with my resume than I am. That sounds impressive when you put it all together like that.
The legendary career, you know, of Bill.
Well, I appreciate it. It's fun to be here. Thanks for having me on your show.
Yeah. So, Bill, how are you and how's everybody doing? Like, how are you doing?
You know, really pretty well right now. You know, there was that long period where COVID shut everything down and I was kind of stuck in the house for a long time, and so now I'm happy to get used to not being stuck in the house. And I like to tell people I'm an introvert by nature and an extrovert by profession. So I got to get out and go do things, and I'm just getting used to doing it again.
Nice. Oh, do you have like a lot of recordings over the time, or since?
That's a great question. I was really lucky. I did have a quite a bit of work over that time. It took us a minute to figure out how to do it, you know, just the technological aspect of how to connect to a studio from your home equipment. But once we all figured that out, and we had to figure it out on both ends. So the very first job that I got during COVID from my home, they had to postpone it because the studio couldn't figure out how to make it work. It was okay on my end, but they couldn't get it to work on their end. And then that eventually passed. And I did, you know, I worked on Ratchet and Clank from home, and I did an episode of Teenage Euthanasia for Adult Swim from home. There's been a few things like that that I've been able to do while all the on-camera actors were kind of, you know, stuck not making money. So it was a really good time to be a voiceover actor.
That's very cool. Yeah, believe it or not, Bill, in 2020, I graduated virtually high school, believe it or not.
Wow, that's, you know, I really feel for my kid is in college. He's just a little bit, he's a few years older than you. And, you know, I feel bad for that whole bunch of you guys who didn't get to do some of the stuff that I got to do when I was your age, because, you know, we're all hiding inside. I actually did... I did a virtual commencement speech for a high school here in Los Angeles that called me up and asked me if I would speak to their high school grads. And so I was able to record that and send it into them. And I was happy that I was able to be a part of it, even just virtually.
Nice. See, if I got that, I'd be like, oh my God, that's Rigby. Oh my, I'm sorry, but if I got that as my speech.
Yeah. Well, I'm glad to do that. That's funny.
Wow. That's pretty, that's really cool. I'm sorry. Wow.
No worries.
Now, Bill, what made you want to become a voice actor and an actor? And who would you say is your biggest inspiration for voice acting and acting? Which is your biggest inspiration?
Well, that's a great question. I fell into voice acting. A friend of mine, Scott Adsit, who you might know as the voice of Big Hero 6. He's a guy that I've known I met him here in LA when I was doing a show with his girlfriend on stage, and he asked me to come in and read for he and his partner Dino Stamatopoulos had pitched and been greenlighted for Moral Oral on Adult Swim. And he called me up one day and said, you know, we're not happy with one of the voices. Would you be willing to come in and read to replace this character? And as you probably know, animation is, well, VO is a small world, and then animation is a smaller world within that. And so I didn't think there was any chance that I was going to get hired for this part. I thought that this was just a friend trying to do me a favor, you know, kind of being, making nice. And I was busy trying to get out of town. I was packing up to go do a season of Summer Stock in Santa Fe, New Mexico. And so I really didn't have time. He kind of had to talk me into coming to read for it. And when I finally did, I wasn't at all nervous because I knew I wasn't going to get the job. So of course I got the job. And then that led to getting my agents at Imperium 7, my wonderful agents. And that led to The Sims. And while I was doing The Sims, which was a big deal, while I was recording for that video game, I got a regular show. And so it just kind of snowballed from there. And I guess if I had it, in my particular situation, Scott Adsit had so much influence on my career. I mean, I wouldn't have a career if it weren't for Scott. I guess I'd have to say he's my inspiration. And he's also a tremendously talented actor and voice actor. And a brilliant improviser. He came up from Second City there in Chicago. So he was a really, really brilliant improviser. As far as acting itself goes, I did my first play in high school when I was 15, and I just knew that's what I wanted to do.
Wow. I have, you know, I think you're a very talented actor and voice actor, Phil.
Thank you. I really appreciate that.
Yeah. And it was really cool to see, like, I think you were in Bedazzled and iCarly, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, that's right. Bedazzled, I got to be the devil, and in iCarly, I got to be French, which is, you know, there's some similarities there. But I'm just kidding. For all you French people out there, I'm kidding. You're not the devil. But it was a lot of fun doing both of those projects because they were unusual, you know. Except I have to say, I don't know if you've seen my clip from iCarly, but we were eating spaghetti tacos, and we had to actually eat them, and that was one of the nastiest things I've ever had in my mouth. And I bet you know Courtney's work too as a voice actor. Courtney, I'm blanking on her last name, which is Courtney Taylor. Yeah. Courtney, who played Starla on the show, she and I met that day because she was also in that episode of iCarly. We both played food judges for that episode, and she was just hilarious and delightful. But the assistant director had to keep coming over and say, guys, you really have to eat the spaghetti tacos. You can't fake it. They were a whole other order of nasty, but the check cleared. So what the heck?
So when I think of Starla, I always think of the Muscle Man song, you know, Starla. I can't sing it, but you know the star.
I do know it, and it's hilarious. And I saw part of your interview with Sam. What was really funny is JG always liked us all to be in the booth at the same time whenever possible. And watching those two do a makeout scene was both hilarious and really uncomfortable. To see Courtney and Sam standing across from the room from each other going, I still have PTSD.
Sorry. That's pretty cool though. Like some behind the scenes. Wow. That's really cool. By far though, I think regular show was like a big, big childhood show of mine. You know, I love that show. Classic.
Well, that's wonderful. You know, I was saying to a friend the other day, if I didn't do anything else right, at least I made some people laugh. So that's not a bad achievement in life, I think.
Okay. Nice. Now, what is your favorite voice acting role you portrayed? Can you please do the voice of your favorite character and favorite acting role you portrayed?
Well, that's tough. You know, it would probably be either Rigby and, you know, all you guys know how he sounds. But I also really enjoyed doing, I was lucky enough to be in the last two animated features that actually had the voices of the real Adam West and Burt Ward from Batman. Mm-hmm. I got to play the Penguin, and they didn't want an exact imitation of the 1960s character, but they wanted something that was reminiscent. And so it was kind of like, Batman, I see you're up to your old tricks. That kind of thing. So I would say it was probably one of those two characters. Rigby, by far, had the biggest influence on my life. As far as shows that I've done, gosh, I've been really lucky in that aspect, too. I've been able to do a lot of really good plays. I guess probably one of my favorites was a play called Lewis Slotin Sonata that was about a Jewish-Canadian physicist who, based on a true story, he worked for our Defense Department in the Second World War, and he was testing the core component for an atomic bomb in a lab, and he exposed himself to a fatal dose of radiation. And the playwright Paul Mullen wrote a play about Slotin's. It took him 9 days to die, and during those 9 days, the play kind of supposes what might have gone through his mind during those 9 days, and that was kind of that was a wonderful lead role. And I just happened to be the right age for it at the right time. And I got to do it in L.A. and also in New York. And so that's probably a favorite. But I've done a lot of really great shows. I've been very lucky in that regard.
Now, if you don't mind, Bill, sorry to ask this. Can you do the ham boning line? That's my favorite line for Rigby.
Ham boning? Ham boning will save your life someday. Ham boning!
I'm sorry, that's really cool. Oh my god. Especially when he does the tap. Sorry.
I say that at a lot of Comic Cons, or at least I did, or 3 years ago. But not many people know, but when I was doing my callback for regular show, I got so into it that I actually did the ham boning while I was doing the line. So I was like, and they laughed, JG laughed, and the casting director laughed, and they were like, that's great, don't do that. Because they needed to get a clean track, without me hitting myself. But yeah, that was a lot of fun.
That's really cool. And then, if you don't mind, too, sorry to ask you, I'll do voices, Bill. Can you do Otto's voice, Otto Octavius?
Yeah, Otto was basically, he was sort of me without... without the humor. So it was it would be like trying to think of one of the lines. I invented this technology, Parker. I think I can handle it. And then later on, of course, when he changed, it would be more like, such a disappointment, Parker. So that's the best thing about Otto was we were doing full body performance capture. So when you see Otto in the game, that's not just my voice, that's actually me. We acted the scenes out fully just like it was a movie, and it was a tremendously fun project to get to work with Yuri Lowenthal and Mark Ralston face to face and play those scenes out. For me, it couldn't have been any more real than if I was, doing the Sam Raimi film or any of that stuff.
Believe it or not, Yuri actually mentioned you during our interview, how you're the best Doc Ock of all time.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah. Wow. Yeah. Well, he was tremendous. I already knew Yuri, and The weird thing about Yuri is that he's exactly as nice as he seems to be. And because we already had a friendship going into Spider-Man, it was easy to play the disappointment, you know, and for Doc Ock, what he interpreted as betrayal and all that, you know, it was really easy to play those scenes because I already knew and liked Yuri. So we kind of brought a relationship, into the filming.
Wow. It's really cool. Yeah. Cause in my interview, like I was asking like people he enjoyed working with, he said by far Bill Salyers was like the best person he's ever worked with and the best Doc Ock, he was saying.
It's really cool. Oh my gosh. I gotta make sure that I'm paying him on time. He's really good. He's good for my ego.
Now, Bill, favorite regular show character other than Rigby, of course.
Oh gosh, there's so many great characters. I mean, you know, it's not a unique choice, but probably Pops because he's just so sweet. He's such a dear character. You know, all the other characters have some kind of messed up agenda going on, whether it's, you know, with admittedly, you know, Mordecai and Rigby are young, so they're just trying to figure out how to move through the world. But Pops is such a genuinely sweet character that I think he's hard not to like. Based on pure weirdness, I would probably say the giant babies, the ones that float around going cake, cake. That actor was David Kay, and you can hear him now all the time on John Oliver's show. John Oliver's show is This Week Tonight or Today Last Week or Yesterday Tomorrow. I don't remember what it's called, but anyway. David Kay, Canadian actor and voice actor, just a tremendously great guy, and he had that deep voice that came out of the baby. So that was a strange episode. The giant babies and, you know, Gary and the El Camino, who sounded like David Bowie, and I don't know what those guys were on, but anyway, yeah. So I think that was it.
Nice, I like that. Also, like, other than, you know, like, I know this is your character, Percy, though, like, his, like, you did, like, a creepy voice for Percy. I'm sorry, but, like, it was creepy.
Yeah. I'm going to draw on your face. Yeah, that creepy doll, that was one of my favorite episodes because they usually, because my voice was so present in the show, they usually wouldn't let me do anything that had a bunch of lines. I was usually, it was, you know, Rigby and then like a line here or a line there, but that particular episode I got to do a full-on second character, and that was really fun.
That's cool too, like you've done like so many characters, you know, like wow, you on a regular show, it's crazy,
honestly. Well, thank you. You know, if you want to be blown away by somebody who did a ton of characters on regular show, that would be Roger Craig Smith. That dude, I used to say that there was me and Sam and JG, and everybody else was Roger Craig Smith. Not true, but not much of an exaggeration. That guy was every other voice you heard. He was tremendous. Talk about a guy with a crazy range. He was the guy. He could do one of his characters. It was Margaret's dad was based on the wrestler who became governor, Jesse Ventura.
He was the guy who talked like this kind of, but
Roger could nail that voice so well, as well as be some teenage kid in a video store, you know, or an undercover cop or what. He could do all of that. Tremendous guy.
I think he wasn't he Thomas? I think if I remember correctly, Thomas.
Yeah, he was Thomas. That's right. Thomas was kind of like, he had already done a gazillion voices on the show, and then when it came time I don't know whether they wrote Thomas and then said, hey, Roger would be great for that, or if they wrote Thomas because of Roger, because I could see that happening. I could see them going, hey, this guy's so talented, let's just write him into the show. And talk about a great storyline, Thomas, you know.
Yeah.
from nobody to secret Soviet spy. Well, wait, no, we couldn't call him a Soviet spy. I can't remember what country we made up, but he was basically a Russian spy. And there was that great, they did that great back, they did those two episodes. There was the one episode where you see Thomas running around doing silly stuff. And then you see it later from his point of view, and he's doing all the secret agent stuff every time he's not actually on camera. Which is, I thought, a really clever. The writers for Regular Show just blew me away. They still do.
I think too, if I remember correctly, wasn't Rigby the one that found out that, or thought that Thomas was bad from the start?
Yes.
I think he was.
Yeah. Nobody would believe it. They all just thought that he was jealous of Thomas. Yeah, that's right.
I remember. See, I remember this because I love Regular Show. Like I said, it's probably like my favorite show.
Uh-huh.
So that's
all. Well, I really appreciate that.
Yeah. Now, this might be tough. Would you be willing to come back to voice Rigby again? Like, if they had another season and another episode, would you be willing to come back? Sorry to ask that.
No. As things stand right now, you know, in the absence of any other thing going on, I would absolutely love to. I love that character. I love the show. I have to be honest though. I doubt that if they, I think they probably will redo the show because it was such a popular property for Cartoon Network. I think they probably will redo it at some point in the future. I'd be surprised if they asked me to do Rigby again. And the reason that is because they'll probably want to ask someone younger. I would prefer that not to be the case, but that's just kind of the way Hollywood works. So, I've seen that happen to friends of mine who create a role. Paul Eiding, who was Grandpa in Ben 10, he created that role and he's the right age for it. And years later, when they remounted Ben 10, they recast it with somebody younger. Mm. It's unfortunate, but it's just kind of the way it works. But to get back to your question, yeah, I would do Rigby again in a heartbeat. I feel like I really probably understand him better than anyone other than JG who created him, you know.
I if they ever do replace you, I'd be like, you're still my Rigby. Sorry, Bill, but you are still my
Thank you, Joe. I appreciate that.
Yeah,
I really do.
Is there a role you would love to do they haven't done yet? Like a time travel, a superhero, or you know, you did super villain. Penguin. Sorry.
Well, funny you should say that. I've read a few different projects. I've read for the Joker, and I would love to play. I would love to do the Joker. I think Mark Hamill kind of did the definitive vocal performance of the Joker, and so I'm afraid mine tends to sound like his because he influenced me so much. But I think that would be a great fun character to do. It's funny you should ask me that because. I was asked that years ago and I said the Penguin, and not long after that I got to play the Penguin. So, you know, fingers crossed.
Breaking news. Gets cast this Joker.
Yeah, there you go.
That'd be cool. Wow. I think too, I'm sorry I keep asking. I think Mark Hamill is Skips too, you know, Regular Show Skips.
Mark was and is tremendous. He's another guy who I would find myself wondering if anybody told Mark that Mark was a superstar cultural icon because he never acted like it. He was always just such a nice, normal presence in the booth. He's very smart and he would say funny things. He always was reading something interesting in between takes. He's a very voracious reader and tremendously kind and someone I'm proud to call a friend these days.
All the years you're the one that was tough is the one after this. My bad. Sorry about that, Bill.
That's all right. Oh, now I'm nervous. But go ahead. Oh, yeah.
Over the years of your career, do you still keep in touch with co-stars and directors you've worked with? You still keep in touch?
Oh, often. Yeah. Well, it's just sort of the nature of the business that you tend to work with friends. Someone that I talk to and frequently and work with regularly is Chris Salter, Chris Zimmerman, who used to direct Regular Show. She still does a lot of she does a lot of video games and a lot of animation, and I see and talk to her frequently. And in fact, we were together at the Close Enough party recently that I spoke of, and she also directed me in Spider-Man. So you tend to meet. She's one of a handful of people in terms of directors that I work with and stay in touch with, and then quite a few of the actors, the voiceover community, comprised of a lot of really lovely people, and we tend to see each other often. I tend to be aware of what they're doing. You know, it's just it's a very collegial bunch of folks, and with most of them with very little ego, which is lovely, considering where we live and what we do. I would say that I'm still in touch with. I was a young stage actor in Seattle during the 90s, and I'm still in touch with a lot of the people that I acted in theater with there.
I like that. You're like very humble, you know, very humble.
Well, that's sweet of you to say. I mean, I probably, how do I put this? Exposure. It's weird to refer to oneself as some people have used the word celebrity. I say I'm a celebrity, BITTY, because it's the smallest unit of fame possible without being totally unknown. But I think I enjoy the work that the being looked at by people and being recognized in public and that kind of stuff. That's actually the least appealing part of it for me. I just enjoy actually doing it. That's my favorite. I love doing the work, and that's why I started it when I was a kid, and that's why I still do it.
Nice. Pretty cool. Now, do you still keep in touch with your old co-star that played Eileen, Minty Lewis?
I saw Minty the other day at the party. Minty is a parent of young people, and so Minty's very busy herself, but I did see her the other day, and she looks great. She sounds great. I think she's winning at life. So I'm glad you asked about that. I was really, really tickled to see her.
I like that. Because I figure I imagine like some people, like she's your wife, girlfriend in the regular show, you know?
Yeah. They pretty much imply in that final episode that she and I end up together with a Basilic kid.
That's really cool, though. Like you and... No, wait, I'm going to sound stupid, though. Is Eileen like a squirrel? Sorry.
That's not stupid. Oh, no, that's not stupid. That's been conjectured a lot. I think she's technically a mole.
A mole. Okay.
Yes. So, mole. You know, a mole and a raccoon hooked up and lived happily ever after.
Nice. So I couldn't tell because, like, she looked human to me and a squirrel. I don't know if that makes sense.
Yeah. You know, funny story about that is I've done a few cons in New Zealand now. Mm-hmm. And the first time I was over there, these sweet New Zealand kids kept coming up to me and going, I really like your squirrel. He's a very fun squirrel. And I would say, thank you, but he's a raccoon. And they'd look puzzled and walk away. And I kept telling people, he's a raccoon. And then finally an adult said to me, we don't have any raccoons here. So that's why they don't know. There are no raccoons in New Zealand, so they didn't know what I was supposed to be, which I thought was hilarious. Like, who doesn't have raccoons? New Zealand, that's who.
Wow. So you got a mole, you said mole and a raccoon. That's an interesting combo. Sorry, that's interesting.
Only in a world where a blue jay is, you know, four times bigger than a raccoon.
True. Yeah. That's cool. Like, well, it was like cool. Like the final episode. The thing I was sad about though was Pops. You know, I'm not gonna spoil. Oh, you know.
Yeah. Yeah. That ripped my heart out. There were some damp eyes in the recording booth that day for sure. Mm-hmm. And but what a great thing for Sam to get to play. You know, what a great arc that character had.
Yeah. Well, it was like wow. That was a touching episode. You know. Sorry. That may sound cheesy.
Said. No, I thought so too. I was, you know, by that time, I was totally invested in the other characters. They were, you know, I felt like I knew them like real people. And so when that happened, it felt tragic.
Yeah. And what I also like really liked about regular show, I don't know if this is because maybe JG liked it or not, 80s music. The music, soundtrack.
Yeah. Yeah, that was the music of my youth, because that's the age I am. Did you see the movie? Did you see the regular show movie?
Yes. Yeah, of course. Sorry.
I'm always surprised by there are people that are really familiar with the series that don't even necessarily know that we made a movie. Mm-hmm. But I'm proud of that film because I think the storyline is so great.
Yeah, it was really cool. Like I think I own like the DVD. Like it's downstairs. I couldn't fit it. Cause, like, sorry. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
That's awesome. Yeah.
Because I love regular show. Like I said, it's like the best show of all time. Classic.
Well, that's great. Thank you, Joe.
Yeah, no problem. Now, this is the tough one, Maritori. Who would you say is the coolest person you have worked with? The coolest.
Oh, my gosh.
Sorry if that's tough, but that's why I gave you a warning.
Well, it's tough because I know a lot of people who strike me as cool. And then there's people that I've worked with that the public thinks is cool as well. Well, one answer would be Donald Glover, Childish Gambino, who's a tremendous star in his own right and is on the series Atlanta right now. But I probably have to say Mark, because I saw Star Wars when I was 13, and I don't know anyone I've never worked with anyone who is more of a cultural icon than Mark is, who's more known by more people. He is the famous nerd that famous nerds geek out in front of. And so, I'd probably say Mark is the coolest person I've ever worked with. But, we got a great – one of the things that Regular Show was really good at was they would pull in these stars who were there because their kids or their grandkids, really liked the show. And so I was constantly amazed by the guest stars that would show up just to record, a little bit, or – if I wouldn't meet them, I would find out that they had come in, because sometimes because of their schedule, they got their own sessions. But there were people that would come in and record for that show that I was like, man, are you kidding me? We got who? So, it was a really cool show that way. The people that would come in and do little parts on it.
Sorry, I ask a side question. I take it as Luke your favorite Star Wars character? Luke Skywalker?
Yes, I've never been asked that before, but yes, I find him relatable because, I grew up in really no town at all, out in the middle of the country in rural Oklahoma, and ended up in Los Angeles, being interviewed by folks like you. And so I think that makes Luke relatable to me, because he was kind of a farm boy who ended up with a destiny that he never anticipated, and I kind of feel like that. So yeah, I would say Luke.
I like that, because I'm a big Star Wars.
Either that, or the little guy who sat on Jabba the Hutt's shoulder and always went. That guy, he's very relatable to me too. One of those two.
Yeah, because I'm a big Star Wars nerd too. Like, I believe it or not, I actually met three Star Wars people in real life.
No kidding. Who did you meet?
I met Hayden Christensen. You might know who that is. Oh,
yeah.
Anakin. I met Ahmed Best. He played Jar Jar Binks.
Yeah.
And then I met Peter Mayhew 2 weeks before he sadly passed. Chewbacca.
Wow, you met Peter Mayhew. That's so cool. I saw him from afar at cons when he was signing, but I never met him. That is really cool.
He's got like big hands, like, of course bigger than this, but big hands.
Yeah, that figures. Yeah, that is a shame. I know that he was in poor health towards the end, and that's tough.
Yeah, because I'm a big, like I said, Star Wars nerd. So when you said when you mentioned Luke Skywalker, Mark Hamill, like, Star Wars.
Yeah, that's, there would be times in the booth when something would remind Mark of a story from that original movie. And we would all just, everything would come to a halt and we would just listen, you know, nobody wanted to make him stop or interrupt him or anything. And we would just listen to him tell a story about being in Morocco and shooting, working on Star Wars, you know, because we were all nerded out. We were all fans. And the other funny thing is, the number of times somebody would make a casual reference to Star Wars while Mark was in the room, when Star Wars would sort of enter the conversation indirectly. Like, I remember one time Roger was getting a piece of direction, and a lot of times actors will rephrase the direction back to the director to make sure they understand it. Roger said, these aren't the droids you're looking for, kind of thing. And you know, immediately we all kind of clocked it, and Mark just grinned. But you know, there was this, like, this weird, like, Star Wars showing up while Mark Hamill's sitting there in the room. It was just kind of funny.
Wow. Sorry, I keep asking side questions. Do you have, like, a favorite Star Wars film then?
Oh, well, yes. I have to disagree with my kid. I don't think CGI adds anything special to storytelling. I think, you know, special effects are great. I have a special place in my heart for practical special effects like those guys did. But I think my favorite is probably Empire Strikes Back, because it's a part of that old original storyline, and it's a little darker, more adult story than the first movie. So that would be my pick with Empire.
See, mine would be like Return of the Jedi. That's my favorite.
Oh, okay. Yeah. I've honestly lost track of how much. I haven't even seen any of The Mandalorian. I've lost track of how much there is going on.
Personally, like the newer trilogy, like, it's not the same as the originals, you know?
Maybe. Right. Yeah. So. Well, that very first movie was a very classic Joseph Campbell hero's journey, you know, of a kid plucked out of obscurity to go do something greater than himself. And you know, that's a super traditional. You see that story a lot. I mean, going back to the ancient Assyrians and the Egyptians, and it's just, you know, there are a lot of, it's a god story for a lot of the ancient mythical gods, that you know, somebody or something is plucked from a normal life, challenged in a way that transforms them and made into something greater. It's a great classic storyline.
Yeah, I like that. Now, what director taught you the most? Is there a director you want to work with that you haven't worked with yet?
What director taught me the most? Heavens, that's really good. You know, I feel like I pick up something different from everyone I work with. Even if on those rare occasions they've been rare, even if it's not terribly pleasant, if for whatever reason we don't necessarily get along, I feel like I learn from every director that I've had. Who I've learned the most from, it would probably be somebody that I worked with, 15, 20 years ago when I was still trying to learn. It would probably be one of those early directors, because once you learn the basics, certainly once, in my experience, once you are working at the level that I'm at, and that, you know, Sam and Roger, those guys are at, you get much less direction, because they kind of, you know, everybody's, it would probably be one of those younger experiences when I was still trying to learn the basics. You know what I mean? When you reach a point where, like, anything you learn is kind of coincidental, because they're paying you to show up and do the job. They're not paying you to learn on the job. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So you're less likely to have something, revelatory come out of that situation because everybody's on the clock. Does that make sense?
That makes sense.
Yeah. Yeah. So I, you know, that would be it, like I say, it's tough to answer, but it would probably be someone from back in the day.
I like that. Now, if you didn't go into like voice acting, what do you think you would have done as a career instead? And what other interests and hobbies do you have besides voice acting and acting? What interests and hobbies?
I'm a big old nerdy video gamer. I love gaming. I have to game on a PC. I just can't get consoles to work for me. It's like, I was like, you know, I should try one of the games that I love, one of my old games I'm really familiar with on a console and see, you know, if I can adjust that way. And so I was trying to play Call of Duty on a PS4 and, and like all the Germans would be shooting me and I'd be like, I was the worst soldier in all of World War II. But with a mouse and a keyboard, I've got finer control. And I love immersive first person experiences. Like, I am replaying right now a modded version of Fallout 4 and, really enjoying that. That's also a franchise I worked in. I was in Fallout 4 and Fallout 76. Another one that I really loved that I also happened to be in was Skyrim. That kind of, you know, first person, right? You've got it right there. Yeah, that I really like that kind of like immersive, get lost in a world. Bethesda does that really well. You know, they create a world. I remember reading a review of Skyrim back when it came out, and somebody was saying that like they were in the game world and they just watched ants crawling on a log for minutes because they so admired the detail that went into that. So, yeah, so gaming is a hobby. I enjoy writing, although I really should be a lot better at it. As far as what was the other part of the question with acting?
If you didn't like go into like acting or voice acting, what do you think you would have done instead as a career?
I'm sorry, hit me with that again.
Oh, that. If you weren't a voice actor and actor, what do you think you would have done as a career instead? Like your other career?
Oh. I think I would have been in science somehow. Oh. Because I really dig I have a number of the plays that I've done, you know, whether it was Lewis Slotin's Sonata or in another play I played one of the Francis Collins, one of the co-mappers of the human genome. I find all that stuff really interesting. So when I like to do research when I play a role, so I sound believable when I talk about that, whatever, you know. And so I think I would have probably gone into some kind of science because I always enjoyed that. The math might kill me, but yeah. If it didn't, that's what I would like to do, I think.
So, like, would you say Dr. Octavius is almost like you? Because didn't he like science a little bit in a way?
He was super relatable to me from that standpoint, you know. And I tried really hard not to. I didn't really have to try hard. I didn't so much think about who, you know, the mythos behind the character. I tried to pretty much stay with the script that I was given. So. To me, Doc Ock could have been, his name could have been anything, you know. It was his experience that I was really trying to create and trying to do it in an honest way. This is something that I love about the guys at Insomniac when they wrote the script. You know, a lot of times Doc Ock is portrayed as just ego and evil. You know, he's, you know, I am brilliant, I'm the greatest brother. And I like the way, in my opinion, the Insomniac guys created a Doc Ock who it was believable and even earnest in his desire to make the world a better place, you know. And I always think I've played a fair amount of villains of various kinds, and I find villains are always more interesting when they genuinely believe they're doing the right thing. You know, I don't think anybody, even the worst person among us, wakes up in the morning and says, how can I make the world a worse place? you know, what can I do that's going to screw everybody up? I think they honestly believe they're doing the right thing, which mm-hmm. makes for a much more compelling performance. And mm-hmm. I totally credit the writing in Marvel Spider-Man for that, because they wrote a doc. In my opinion, I think it's written more with more depth than the role that Fred Molina plays in the movies. I feel like mm-hmm. I feel like they do strike a balance, but I feel like Insomniac delivers more on that idea of Otto as a genuine person whose arrogance doesn't come from the fact that he thinks he's God's gift. It comes from the fact that he knows what he knows, and he knows how much he knows, and anybody questioning that is just standing in the way of the progress he's trying to achieve for mankind. So, yeah.
No, sorry. Another side question: what did you base your Rigby voice off of? I know it's like almost like your normal voice, but like,
that's great. I didn't have much information at all in the audition when I did it. It was a handful of lines, and they didn't really say much about the character. I just had his name, but it was clear to me that he was kind of angsty and hadn't really found his chill, and so I thought, well, I'll just play him like me on way too much coffee. And so, you know, I love that chair turned into, I love that chair. You know, that's sort of like everything turned to 11 kind of thing. And they didn't, I mean, that was the voice I auditioned with. That was the voice they had me do for the Cartoon Institute pilot on YouTube. And that's the voice that I ended up using in the show.
Oh, and when you mentioned coffee, I'm sorry, but that was a crazy episode. Do you remember the coffee bean? That was a crazy episode.
Oh, geez. Yeah, where the coffee beans running around squirting people. And yeah, that was really strange. And that says, would you say a particular episode of regular show is strange? That's really strange.
Yeah. I'm sorry, but when you know what I'm talking about. When he's
squirting. Yeah, yeah, I know exactly what you're thinking of. Yes. Yeah. I'm glad my coffee comes out of a pot instead.
Yeah.
Yeah. What are your favorite games?
I play Fortnite, Call of Duty, Minecraft. I do a sport games. I go a variety.
Yeah. Have you tried Back for Blood at all?
Yes, and you're in that, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, that's right. I was just curious. It sounds like you do a lot of multiplayer online. I didn't know if that was something you tried.
I have a gaming library, so if you saw it, like, oh my god.
Yeah, I bet. What's your platform? What do you like to game on?
Okay, before I tell you, what do I look like? What kind of game do I look like? What kind of gamer?
Oh, that's gonna be tough. I'm gonna go. Anything I say, this is dangerous territory, because I realized what I was about to say was probably going to piss off a lot of Xbox fans. I was going to say, you're really smart. You look like a PlayStation guy to me. Yeah. What? Are you serious?
Yeah, you're right.
Get it? Yeah.
He's your million dollars. He's your million.
Excellent. Wow. Yeah. It's like, the PlayStation people I know, It's more, you know, everybody's got an Xbox. My kid has an Xbox, so I can say this. But the PlayStation people I know are you know, they tend to gravitate towards superior hardware, and at least when I was messing around with one back in the day, the PlayStation was considered a better computer per se than the Xbox. I don't know where it's at now, because, like I say, you hand me a joystick and I'll try to shove it up my nose. I don't know. But so I do, all of my games are through Steam or GOG or Epic, you know, all those online.
Did you ever play Fortnite before, Bill? You ever try it?
I have not played Fortnite. So my impression of Fortnite from seeing my son Ian play it is that it looks like pretty much a battle arena game. Is that the case?
It's almost like, because you know Minecraft, right? Like how you build things and all that. Minecraft. It's almost like Minecraft meets Call of Duty.
Oh wow. Wow.
It's like that.
So are you building fortresses kind of thing? Like defensible.
Like you build like structures like so that we don't get shot.
Yeah. Be safe. Wow. Yeah, I usually like to look for something with a pretty deep story. That always you know, that always really appeals to me. Anything where, I'll tell you one that's coming out that I'm really excited about, that for some reason I'm not in, is I think it's called Starfield. It's I think that's a Bethesda game. And it's been described as like Skyrim in space, because it's again that sort of like really immersive world kind of game, but set out amongst the stars. And I'm not just a game nerd, I'm a sci-fi nerd, so that sounds really, really great.
Same. Yeah. I love time travel. I'm a big time travel sci-fi nerd, so
time travel stuff is fascinating. Like all the paradoxes and
you know,
never gets old.
But you're not in that game, you said? That star.
I'm not. Not yet. Hello, if you're out there, here I am.
Yeah, if he's in it, I'll play. If he's in it, I'll play.
Yeah, there you go. See? You'll get a fan. Yeah, it's funny because here's the funny thing. I may have auditioned for it and didn't know it because all of our auditions are they give us code names for we don't know the game until we actually get hired, if ever. So wow. You know, we'll get an audition and it'll be like, you're reading for the role of Jack in Two Shovels, and okay, you know, so then Two Shovels turns out to be like the latest Star Wars game or, you know, so you like, you just don't know. I've worked on things that were so, I think this was a Fallout game. Actually, I've worked on games that were so secretive that I literally didn't know what I was playing or what I was working on until I walked in the booth. So I'm sitting out in the waiting room, you know, I report for work. I'm sitting out in the waiting room in the lobby waiting to be called in to record, and I still don't know what the game is. And yeah.
Wow. I'm sorry, but wow, that's crazy.
Yeah. There's some companies are super secretive. I was not allowed to talk about Doc Ock for months after everybody else announced, like, you know, Yuri was talking about playing Spider-Man. You know, everybody was talking about the participation, and I had been asked not to because they really wanted Doc Ock to be a surprise. And then another actor accidentally leaked it and didn't go over well with the Insomniac folks.
If you don't mind, I don't want to sound stupid. Did Regular Show have like a code name? You honestly said code names.
Did Regular Show what? I'm sorry?
Have like a code name, like how you said, like these games have code names, like you don't know, or the regular show.
I don't remember what I read for it, but a lot of times the animation doesn't bother to do that because it's already been announced that the project exists. So they don't necessarily, particularly if it's ongoing, if it's not a pilot, if it's ongoing, a lot of times they will have you. A lot of times you'll have to sign an NDA just to audition. So I do that a lot. Yeah.
Bill, favorite band or artist and type of music?
Oh gosh. I'm dreadfully vanilla that way. My favorite music probably comes from the 90s, the 80s. I'm going to say maybe Talking Heads.
Okay. Once in a lifetime.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, and the lead singer, they're not together anymore, but David Byrne was just recently on Broadway with a show that featured his music. So he's still very active and very experimental stuff. And even back in the day when Talking Heads first came out, they were considered very different. So yeah, I'm old fashioned. I like the music from when I was your age, you know.
Nice, because my mom and my dad, they raised me in 70s, 80s, and 90s music. Believe it or not. So.
Yeah, it's funny that it's been amusing to me to see the 80s come back. You know, as somebody who was young and lived through them, to see people be nostalgic about the 80s is kind of amusing for me.
Nice. I bet it'll shock you who my favorite band is, though. I bet it'll shock you.
Who?
My favorite band. I bet it'll shock you. Do you want me to tell you, or you want to take a guess?
Hit me. Oh, gosh. You're too eclectic. I can't even imagine. It could be anything from contemporary to, like, classical. I don't know.
Well, I can give you a hint. There's four members, but one passed away in the 90s. So help.
In the 80s?
Yes.
Nirvana?
And they sing all types of music. There's 70s, 80s, and 90s types of music.
I can't imagine.
They're British. If that helps.
I don't know.
Do you know Queen?
Oh, Queen. Oh. So you're referring to Freddie Mercury, who passed away.
Yeah.
Oh, my gosh. That's a really good choice. Kudos to you. Good choice. Yeah, talk about, it's funny, I saw a Queen tribute band a little while back, and, you know, you can't imitate Freddie Mercury. He's just, that dude was, like, stupid talented. There's just, his range was ridiculous. Yeah. But that's a good choice. Queen is a good choice, and you're right, I never would have guessed it.
Yeah, because, like you said, like, Freddie, though, hey, like, nobody could replace him. Like, he's one of a kind, I mean, like.
Yeah, that's voice. Right.
Powerhouse voice, like he could, especially the live aid performance, how he would like say the A, or you know what I'm talking about, but like he would, wow.
Yeah, he was somebody who could croon a love song or blast a rock anthem and be amazing in both.
Yeah. Wow. So I blew your mind with the choice.
Yes. Between me and between regular show and Queen, I think you have excellent taste.
Thank you. Yeah. Like I said about Regular Show, though, great music choices. You know, they had Loveable, you know, Working for the Weekend.
Yeah, that was Mark Mothersbaugh. And speaking of somebody from another great band.
Evo, sorry.
pardon me. Evo?
Is he singing from Evo?
Yeah. And I was always amazed at what they were able to get. The groups that they were able to get, because a lot of that music, sometimes we wouldn't be able to get stuff because it would just be too expensive, but you know, some of that stuff that they got just blew me away. They got a lot of great music for that show.
Yeah, I think Devo don't sing like Whip It, like Crack That Whip.
Yeah. Yeah, that's Devo.
Yeah, see, I bet I'm like, how the heck does Joe know all these 80s?
I know, for real, like, that's wild, that's encyclopedic.
I got you. Now, favorite sports and favorite teams, do you like sports at all, Bill?
Do I like sports?
Yes, your favorite sports and team.
We always joke about, in my family, we joke about the fact that I'm so sports ignorant. You know, I'll say things like, basketball, that's the one with the touchdowns, right? It's not really that bad, but you know, my kid was into soccer, and so then I started kind of following LA Galaxy and that was when who was that great soccer player that was married to one of the Spice Girls, still is, I think.
David Beckham.
Yeah, that was when Beckham had just come to the States and had just moved here, and I went to go pick up my kid after a soccer game once, and I saw Beckham in his car, and he waved at me. So now I'd say David Beckham. but I love. I'm not much on American football. I prefer European football or soccer, and I like things that tend to move quickly. I tend to prefer basketball. I tend to prefer something like fencing. Where there's things. My wife is a huge baseball fan. My favorite thing about baseball is beer and hot dogs.
And spend time with
Bois. There's so much of baseball that's like waiting for somebody to do something, you know.
Yeah.
Anyway, so that's kind of my not very good answer to that question.
I would say spending time with the wife too, right? You know, hot dogs, beer, and
wife. Yeah, we've done that. We've gone to watch the Dodgers play, and that's been fun. It's just that as sports goes, I don't think of it as something that really has pace, you know.
Yeah.
See, it's amazing. I've seen just in neighborhood like pickup games, I've seen such amazing artistry in basketball that really impresses me. I've seen players do things where I thought that he's defying gravity. That doesn't make any sense. Like, I know physics doesn't work like that. You can't jump up and then float 4 feet. And yet it seems like somebody did that, you know?
Mm-hmm. See, I like hockey. You know, hockey's like fast paced. Oh, hockey
moves. You know what? My only problem with it, I would like to actually be at a hockey game. My problem with hockey is I can't keep track of the puck. It just moves so fast. I'm like, I don't know. Like, you know, they need a puck that's about a foot and a half wide. And then I can keep. But then I guess you're into curling territory, and so there you go. You have like a cross between hockey and curling. So like it moves a little slower, but you never lose track of the puck. You could call it hurling, or yeah, this is going no place good. I should stop talking right now.
You could call it cocky.
That's the thing. Thank you for going there, because you kept me from going there. I appreciate it. That's where I was headed, and I was like, no, Bill, no, shut up. Bite your tongue.
Now, favorite food. What's your favorite food, Bill? What does Bill like to eat? What kind of food do you like?
Anything that doesn't outrun me. I live in Southern California, and I love Mexican food. But if I had to choose between giving up that and Japanese, I'd be really torn, because I love me some sushi. So, those are my two favorite cuisines, I think, with Italian being a close go-to right behind.
Well, yeah, see, I'm Italian, personally. Gazzito, that's my last name. Italian.
Uh-huh. Well... Yeah. I mean, there's nothing wrong with good Italian food, whether that's, you know, pizza or ziti or whatever. That's some good stuff.
Yeah. You said ziti. My last name's Zito, so Zito, ziti.
I know, right? I know.
So you got it. Yeah, because maybe if you ever, because you're all in Chicago, if you ever come to Chicago, you get good pizza. We got you. So.
I don't know why, but you cut out once in a while and you just cut out again. What was it?
Maybe whenever you come to Chicago, we'll treat you out to a good pizza.
Oh, I would love that. You know, we just had Gino's East open here like a year ago. And there is no deep dish pie that I like more than Gino's. I don't think it's like I don't like these deep dish pizzas that are like mostly crust, you know, it's like, yeah. I want filling. I want that delicious tomato sauce and
yes.
Pepperoni and yeah. Mm. Yeah, Chicago's got some great food. I was through there. I wasn't there long. I was traveling somewhere, and I got just a sandwich and a hole in the wall in O'Hare, and it was amazing.
Wow. Yeah, because I don't know if you knew, believe it or not, the start of quarantine, Sam was telling me he actually lived out here for a little bit. Sam Marin?
Yeah.
He told me he lived out here for a little bit, which is crazy. Yeah,
Sam was there for a while. He... I know he wanted to focus on theater, which I thought was really cool, because and I saw Sam on stage in a play. I went and saw him, and he's quite good, you know, as you would expect him to be. It doesn't pay like doing VO or being on camera, but it sure is a lot of fun. It's the thing that I enjoy. Doing plays is the thing that I enjoyed most until I did full performance capture, and then I like that even more, because it you didn't have to worry about where you were facing or any of that. You were surrounded by 400 cameras, so you just played the scene any way you wanted, and I found that very freeing.
Nice. Now, now that, you know, things are getting back to normal, do you have any projects that are coming up in the works?
I do. You know, the drag about what we do is that by the time you can talk about it legally, you've practically forgotten it. That's what, you know, it's all NDAs. That's probably the most recent thing that I can talk about is Back for Blood. Because other stuff that I've worked on hasn't launched yet. And that put me in trouble. So I can't do that, but I'm working on some fun stuff that I'm looking forward to getting out to the fans.
Like that. Now, what is your advice for younger people or people that become like an actor, actress, voice actor, voice, you know, what's your advice?
Well, I think a lot of people, believe it or not, I think a lot of people pursue it for the wrong reasons. Like I talk to people, particularly younger people, will say to me some version of how do I make money acting? And that's a legit question. I understand why people would ask it, but in my opinion, acting to make money is dumb, because there's always going to be a million more people than jobs. One of the things that you discover pretty early on is you can be really, really good, and you should be really, really good, but everybody in the room reading against you is also really, really good. So being really good at what you do is just, that's like the starting gate. That's like a lottery ticket that gets you in the door. And then there's so much that's out of your control. You know, if you happen to remind the casting director of an ex-boyfriend or girlfriend, or, you know, the producer decides that he wants his nephew to play the role. Like there's so much that's out of your control. The only reason to do it, in my opinion, is because you absolutely love it. And if you absolutely love it and you do it, even though you don't get paid, you would do it even if you had to pay to do it, then odds are you're going to do it long enough that you'll get really good and your network will rise and somebody might offer you money to do it. You know, but if you're going to go into acting for the money or for fame, which is also, you know, going into acting for fame is like standing on top of a hill with a lightning rod to try to get struck by lightning. It might happen, but it's completely random. Right. And so the only real reason to do it is because you love it. And if you do it because you love it, you might end up getting paid for it. That's just my opinion.
I could also add, like, stay humble and remember where you came from. Like, don't get cocky. Like, think you're all that, you know what I mean?
Oh, yeah. Don't believe your own press. If you become known at all, people will say wonderful things about you. And that's very sweet. And the proper response is to thank them and then get back to work. You know, it's not something you want to dwell on, because that could lead to bad decisions on your part.
Now, Bill, would you be willing to come back on for a part two answering fan submitted questions?
Sure. Okay, yeah, I'll do that.
I just want to ask you, because I was thinking, because it's like a regular show Reddit page that probably people love to ask questions for Rigby. Sorry. Would you be willing to come back on? Because maybe I could ask people if they have any questions for you, and I could ask, like so-and-so asks and then the question.
That'd be fun. I would be happy to do that.
Perfect. I figured I'd ask you that. Like, that way people can all submit questions, after this, video airs.
So, there you go.
Thank you. Also, Bill, before I ask you my last question, do you have any questions? Do you have any questions?
Well, I think I asked them. I was really interested in some of your tastes and some of what you like to do. That was pretty much what I wanted to know, like, as a fellow gamer, what you were into and that kind of stuff. And I think you answered it. So, yeah, I appreciate that.
Yeah, I could tell you, if you want me to, why I started these podcasts, if you want me to.
Oh, that'd be great. Yeah, I would love to know.
Yeah. I started these April of 2020, and I figured I'd start these to help spread positivity, help cheer people up during this tough, negative time, the pandemic, help cheer people, That's why I started these.
That's very cool. That's very cool. Well, and I saw that you've actually got quite a body of work built up now. How many have you done total?
Currently, I'm at 125 or 126.
Wow. Yeah. Wow, that's really impressive.
Yeah, if you saw, I've interviewed, you know, you saw your fellow co-star Sam Aaron, Tom Kenny, Sean Astin.
Yeah.
But I'm getting my favorite interview, William Salyers. You know, that's my favorite.
Oh, I bet you say that to all the interviews.
But you're actually my favorite, though. You're like I said, like probably my favorite show of all time. Regular show, favorite character.
Thank you, Joe. I really appreciate it.
So, Bill, is there anything you would like to promote and shout out that I got linked down below to help you out?
Say that again one more time.
Sorry about that. Is there anything you would like to promote and shout out that I got linked down below in the video description?
I'd like to promote. yes, there is stuff I'd like to promote. And no, I can't do it. No, I don't need any more lawyers in my life. So, I'm not going to be, but yeah, there's stuff that I so wish I could talk about. And maybe by the time you and I do our next visit, maybe I can.
Do you want me to link down your Twitter and Instagram page? Do you want me to do that for you? So people can follow you.
Yeah, that'd be great. You can find me, Twitter's probably the best way to get to me. And it's just, WL Salyers.
Okay.
At WL Salyers, yeah.
Yeah, I already follow you on Twitter, so I got you.
Oh, you do? Oh, okay, great.
Yes. I'll say follow Bill here on Twitter and then the Twitter link.
Yeah, I appreciate that.
Got you. Well, thank you, and Bill. I had a great, fun time chatting with you. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, Joe. It was a real pleasure, and I hope you stay safe and happy.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody, for watching, and thank you, and Bill. Have a great day, everybody, and stay awesome, and you stay awesome, Bill.
You too, brother. Thank you.